Welcome back to another episode of Encounter with God Together. I'm so happy to be with my friend Gil Rolon today, who he has been in pastoral ministry for the last 35 years with really a special heart for prison ministry and has worked in prison work for 35 years as well. And I've known Gil for many, many years, and I'm just pleased to have him join with us today. So welcome, Gil.
Thank you, Gail. It's a pleasure and it's an honor to be asked to share God's word. It's my heart to do that. Value our friendship throughout the years very much. Without sounding a little crazy, I'm really proud of where you're at. And no, I really am. And as I've seen your journey and where God has taken you from one extreme to another, I mean, the president of Scripture Union. And just really excited to see the way that God is using you. And I'm really excited for the future of this organization, having you at the helm. It really is. It's very exciting.
Yeah. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Yeah. So Gil, why don't I go ahead and pray for you as you start today.
Thank you.
For us as we gather together. Father, I thank you so much for Gil, for his love for your word, for his passion for sharing with those who don't know you. And I pray that you will inspire him by your spirit as he speaks and give him words to share with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much, Gail. Thank you.
So we're continuing on in Encounter with God through the book of Mark. We're in Mark 9 and 10. And you're gonna tee that up for us this week.
I am.
So I'm gonna turn it over to you for your thoughts.
So we're picking up in Mark chapter 9. And Jesus basically, with chapter 9 and into chapter 10, he's trying to impress the disciples what it means to be a follower. He needs to be killed. He's going to be raised from the dead. You know, prophecies have to be fulfilled, the end times. But he's really on a mission with his disciples, and he's trying to share with them, the key of these two chapters are servanthood. You know, he's trying servanthood. And he's really about, it's something that they're not ready for, because they're really expecting this king and this warrior to come in and fight for them. And he's all about, yeah, guys, that's going to happen at some point. But right now, the least of you is going to be a servant, and I'm going to lead by example. You know, and he just shares his heart with them. And I just love the way he maneuvers his way through chapter 9 as he starts his ministry, and he explains the truth of the gospel and the truth about being a real leader for Christ. And real leaders aren't concerned about power. They're concerned about serving. And if we had an attitude of service, wow. I mean, it would really transform the kingdom of Jesus Christ. You know, we're all vying for power. Everybody, everywhere. In our jobs, in our homes, on the street, in the grocery store. You know, who's I'm first, I'm bigger, I'm greater. And that's just so not what Jesus was about. You know, he was all about servanthood. And that's why he washed the disciples' feet. That's why he served them dinner. You know, he served them at the Last Supper. He served them, and they were all like, no, don't do this. He says, no, this is what I'm about, and I want to be an example that this is what you're going to be about. And that's what we're about, serving, you know. And so he shares with them, and he talks about the importance also that we're not perfect. You know, he talks about sin, you know. And I love that he shares that, you know, while we need to live a godly life and be examples and try to live a sinless life in its fullness is not possible. You know, it's not possible, you know, because of our thoughts, because of our heart, because of who we are. It's just not possible. And I love that he addresses it and knows that we're saved by grace, you know, and grace sustains us. Grace is what keeps me and keeps you where we're at, that when I do sin and a bad thought or something I don't do, I don't forgive someone or whatever the sin is in my life, that grace, thank God for grace. I'm reading a book by Max Lucado, one of my favorite authors, and it's called Grace. It's just called Grace, and it's really impacted me. I mean, it's just a wonderful book. If you have a chance to get it, it's just called Grace by Max Lucado. But I want to read something. He says, we won't appreciate what grace does until we surround ourselves with who we are. And what we are is we're rebels. We're Barabbas. We deserve to die. We have four prison walls that surround us. We're surrounded by fear, by hurt, by hate. We're incarcerated by our past. You know, he just talks about, you know, we've been found guilty. But in spite of all that, grace. Grace lives because Jesus lives. Grace lives because Jesus works. Grace lives because Jesus matters. And because he lives and he works and he matters, we are saved by God's amazing grace. And I thank God for grace every day. I really do. Every day I'm just so grateful that in spite of my faults and my temptations and my humanity, even as a minister of the gospel, and I've been serving the Lord, you know, for over 40 years in my life, and most of that in ministry, you know, I'm not ashamed to say, you know, I got sin in my life, and I got to deal with it. You know, I really do. And it's every day. You know what I mean? I've been married to the same woman for 37 years, and I love her to death, but I have issues that I have to deal with, and I thank God for his grace every day and for the cross. And I thank God that the cross is wider than what I thought. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Much wider than what I thought. And I thank God for his grace. And if he allows that grace to me, I sure hope I'm giving that grace to those around me. You know, when they fall, when they stumble, when they sin.
And, yes.
You know, and serve them that way. You know, not be so critical and judgmental. Mm-hmm. And just learn to love them the way that Jesus didn't judge me and condemn me. He loved me. And he said, it's okay. My grace, the cross is wider than that, Gil. It's okay. It's okay. And I thank God for that. And then, we move on to, the passage, one of my favorite passages when he's with his disciples, he's talking about in verses 17 to 24 of chapter 9. I just wanted to focus on it because it's actually one of my favorite passages in scripture. It's just, there's a man in the crowd and he says, Jesus, I brought my son to you. He's possessed with the spirit. You know, he's been robbed of speech. Whenever I go to seize him, he throws himself to the ground. He gnashes his teeth, you know, and he says to them, you unbelieving generation, Jesus replied, how shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. And they brought the boy to him. And immediately the boy went into this convulsion and he went crazy and the disciples couldn't cast him out. We see before that disciples said, we couldn't cast him out. Well, why? And we cast out demons before. And Jesus says, get him over here, get him over here. You know, he brings him over to them. And this is this portion of scripture. You know, I weep when I read it. I really do, because it really, you know, Jesus says in verse 21, Jesus asked the boy, how long has the boy been like this? From childhood, he answered, he has often thrown himself to the fire. He says, but if you can do anything, take pity on us. If you can. And Jesus said, everything is possible for the one who believes. And the Father responds to Jesus immediately. He says, I do believe. Help me in my unbelief.
Yeah.
And I don't know. That just like grasped my heart. It grasped every, from my top of my head, tip of my bones, you know, just that's me every day. You know, every day I said, Lord, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
And I don't know, you know, we have things that happen to us every day and things that we don't understand. And about a year and a half ago, you know, I have a beautiful 5-year-old grandson and I have a 2-year-old adopted grandson that I love to death, you know, with both my boys. But my my older son had a child and his name was 40. And he was born sick, really sick. And we prayed for him by faith, you know, we trusted God, you know, and everything. And 6 months into it, you know, the Lord took him. The Lord took him about a year and a half ago, took my grandson. And I was doing this. Lord, I believe, you know, help me overcome my unbelief. I believe, you know. And yet, you know, he took him. And I thought, Lord, I know you're going to do a great thing. And I just need to trust you. I know some great things are going to happen. And it was weird. As I went through that, I thought, I never lost faith. I never stopped trusting God. I mean, I had questions, you know.
Yeah.
And I said, Lord, help me. You know, I want to believe. I want to understand. And then, I remember I was speaking at a conference during that time. It's Bruce Lake. This is a convention place out here for a campground. And they asked me to speak on Romans 12, but I always read the verses before. And so in reading the verses before, the Lord spoke to me. And he answered the question because I had a lot of people come up to me and ask me, Jim, he said, Gil, why would God allow this? Why would God allow this in your life? It's a great question. I get that asked a lot. I get, you know, why would God allow the pandemic? Why would God allow the COVID? Why would God allow this person to die? Why would God allow this child to suffer? Why would God? And I read this. I read this from, and I just thought, you know, it was really, really, really powerful. From Romans 11, verses 37 to 38, and it says, who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, was what came to me. So the real question is, when they asked me, Gil, you know, why did you allow this to happen? I can answer that question. But when they ask me, why did God allow it to happen? Then I go to, who has known the mind of the Lord? I don't know. I don't know the mind of the Lord. If I did, I can't even do my taxes. I certainly don't know the mind of the Lord. No, I'm just saying, right? I don't know. And that it was really comforting to me to say, you know, I didn't have an answer as a minister, you know, for all these years that I was supposed to come up with some great theological answer. Mm-hmm. And my heart was, I don't know. But I know this, that I trust the Lord and I love him. And I know that he's in control of all things and that someday I'll see my grandson again. And in the midst of all that, the Lord blessed me with an adopted grandson that came into my life. And he's my joy and my life. And I just eat and breathe him. You know, his name's Colton. He's a little African-American boy from Detroit, Michigan. And he just filled my home with joy, like you can't imagine. And he has. The Lord brought him in as he took my one and brought another one into our lives. And I, you know, God had a reason. And we rescued him. We rescued him from a really bad neighborhood in Detroit, Michigan. And I just bless God for him every day. Again, amazing grace, how sweet the sound, saved a wretch like me. Thank you, Jesus, for grace, you know? Yeah. And then, you know, he moves into Mark chapter 10, and there, you know, he's on the other side of the Jordan River, kind of in the area where John the Baptist was doing his ministry, and it ends in Jericho. And the weird thing that's happening, I think it's an interesting dynamic. It was a time where women and children weren't respected at all. They weren't respected at all. And they were downgraded. The men, you know, thought nothing of them. You could divorce a woman by her burning your food. Like, it was really bad. When you read the history behind it, it was really pathetic. I mean, and Jesus stops us, you know, and he says, you know, guys, enough of this. You're not going to be fickle men. And he protects the women. And I love that he does that. And he says, you know, you're both one, and one is not created over the other. You know, the Bible says it was from the rib, not the head to be over him or the feet to be under him, but from the rib to be a sign, to be a companion for him. And I love him for that. I love that that's the way he saw it. We're one in Christ. My wife and I are married 37 years, and we're one. I'm not above her. She's not above me. I'm not below her. She's not below me. We're one. And Jesus emphasized that, and I just love that. And then, you know, a bunch of the children started coming to Jesus. And they started rebuking him. And they said, hey, you know, Jesus, the kids are coming to you. You know, you're trying to get them out of the way. He says, hey, what are you doing? Like, stop. You know, because unto such is the kingdom of heaven. So he defends the children. He defends the women. And I just love that. He's defending the helpless at that time.
Yes.
And that's what he's about. That's what he's all about. He's just so about defending us and protecting his own. You know what I mean? He says, hey, enough of this. And forbid the children not, because unto such is the kingdom of heaven. And I'm like, oh. We better chill out with these children and these women, because he's defending them. You know, he thought that Jesus would be on our side. He says, that's not what I'm about. You know, that's not what I'm about. I'm really grateful, and I'm not just saying this because I'm on this cast. Scripture Union has been really great about helping children. And I love the way that throughout the summer, I see the way that you guys go into these different children ministries and give out pamphlets and do stuff all the time. And I think that's really exciting. For Scripture Union. It really is. It's really neat the way you guys move up to the plate and do what God's called us to do, because the seeds that Scripture Union plants now are going to be, you know, the leaders of tomorrow, the Christians of the ministers of tomorrow, the believers of tomorrow. And if we're not planting those seeds now, then, you know, what do we got? You know, you catch them when they're young. So I just really honor Scripture Union for what they do. It's wonderful. I really do.
Thank
I think it's
you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
I really do. I had in my prison ministry that I've been doing for like 35 years, three years ago, I had an opportunity to go into a children's prison, believe it or not, that they exist.
Wow, I did not know that.
Yeah, and it's right in our area. It's just in Bucks County. And it's behind the major men's prison that you don't see it off the road. And I inquired about it and I got a chance to go in. And it's a prison for 13 to 17 year old kids. It's a prison of boys and girls that are in prison. It's a real prison with the whole nine, except instead of guards, they have counselors, but it is a prison. And I had a chance to go in and share God's word, you know, to these children. And they were children. And it broke my heart. I left there many a night crying. But one young man in particular, his name was Jesse, came in there. His dad was, you know, messed up. Mother was messed up. A lot of these kids are in there because their parents are in prison or on the streets, and it's horrible, you know, but they have no other way to survive. So they go to the streets and they buy drugs and then they get arrested. But that's a whole other thing. But he came in and we gave him the word of God. You know, we gave him his first Bible. And the following week, I came back to see if he had a chance to read a chapter, and he didn't read a chapter. He read the entire New Testament. He was 15 years old. And he said, no, I read from from John to that last book with the long name on it. I'm like, you read from John to Revelation? He says, yeah. And the security guy, the counselor said, yes, he was up at 2 a.m. and I saw the light on it. And I went inside to give him discipline because you can't be up that day. And he had his Bible open and he was reading his Bible at 2 a.m. It was just really neat to see the hunger that he had, the children had for the Word of God. And that day he accepted Christ. You know, he gave his life to Jesus. And as I led him to Christ, along with 14 other kids, when he did it, like 14 other kids, 13 to 17, all received Christ all at once. And that was just like overwhelmed. I was like, oh my God. Amazing. And they all wanted Bibles. It was like something out of a David Wilkerson movie or something. I was handing out Bibles. And then COVID hit and I had to stop. You know, I couldn't go anymore last year. And he was transferred to a prison up north. And he called me every week. Every week he wrote me a letter or he called me every week. And he was telling me how good he was doing. He told me that he got baptized in the water. He told me that he kept reading his Bible. And this went on till like 2 weeks ago. He called me and he said, Pastor Gil, I just wanted to tell you that my mom and dad are home and they want me back home. And I'm leaving the prison and I'm getting a job. He's 18 now. And he says, I just wanted to thank you for sharing God's word. I'm doing really good. I'm going home.
Amazing.
And I wept like a baby. Like a baby. I just wept. And I said, Lord, that's what you called us to do. You know, you called us and don't forbid the children to come because of such is the kingdom of heaven. You know, the Bible says in the book of James that he who hides a soul from sin will hide a multitude of sins to save a soul from death by just one. You know, that one person that got saved is going to hide a multitude of sins. And it's just, I'm just amazed at how God, I mean, every week he'd call me. My wife was like, is that Jesse again? I said, I know. It's Jesse again. He's calling me again. But every week he was growing and growing and growing. To see him now going home, I just can't get past it. You know, and at the end of this chapter 10, as I finish with this, blind Bartimaeus was yelling and screaming at Jesus. This blind beggar, as he's walking by, and his disciples are telling him, hey, shut up, be quiet. You know, the master's coming by. Stop yelling so loud. And he starts crying, no, Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me. Screaming his lungs. And Jesus stops and calls him over and heals him. And blind Bartimaeus' life has changed because he didn't care what other people had to say. You know, what I get from these chapters is in serving, don't be so concerned about what other people have to say. Be more concerned about what Jesus has to say and our roles in that. We're the vessels. We're the eyes, the ears of Christ. We're the hands of Christ. We're the voice of Christ. And so, you know, maybe we're not seeing beggars on the streets every day, but people are begging every day for something. They need answers. You know, the people we work with, the people in the grocery store, our neighbors, our family members that we don't, you know, they're looking at us. We have the bread and we don't share it with them. You know, it's so important to share the word of God and share our faith with others. It's what God would have us to do. Let's be the true body of Christ and say, Lord, use me for your glory. Use me to help to shed a light in someone else's darkness. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I really do. So I appreciate these two chapters. I appreciate the way that God's spoken to us about servanthood and serving others. And you can't out-serve another person. You can't, because that you're just serving God. You know, it's ultimate best. So I just want to finish with a word of prayer, if it's okay, Gail. I just want to pray for those that are listening within the sound of my voice and say, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord, that we can be light. It's a privilege to be a light in the midst of this dark world. It's a privilege to share your word. It's a privilege to have children in our lives to share the word of God to them, Lord, that they may grow to be mighty vessels for the Lord Jesus Christ, to help those that are weak and those that are in need. And that you put us in places for a reason, even when we're not comfortable. Maybe it's not the right place that we feel like, Lord, but I don't want to be where I want to be, Lord. I want to be where you need me to be. Let me be there and use me for your glory, Lord, because I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Gil, for sharing your heart and your personal stories. And I think it's a good lens for us to look at these verses this week as we come to it. I don't know if many of you know, but this is our Bible guide that we've been reading through. Many of you who join us are reading it either online or in email or in this booklet. But we do make these available to prisoners at special request. So if there is someone watching who has a prisoner that they would like to send a copy to, we can make that happen. And so you just reminded me of that. And Gil, I'd love to get one of these actually to your friend
Oh, yeah, you'd love that.
So let's make that happen. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and I hope you'll come back again.
Well, thanks so much for having me, Gail. It's a privilege and a blessing to share the word. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you this week.
God bless you. Bye-bye.